Hello everyone, are you back?
Yes, sir.
Can we start or still wait for your friends? All back? When is your exam? 5th June?
Yeah, 5th.
Yes, Professor.
5th June, okay. So anything about exam pattern? Do you know, have any idea what is the exam pattern?
No, Professor.
Or you want to know?
Yeah, that will be good, Professor.
See, basically, yeah.
I was looking at the question paper, and 55 marks was something which we are going to write based on the questions asked, and 45 marks will be like a case study kind of thing, which will be a scenario, and we need to answer the questions asked.
Excellent. This is ABC section. Okay, A section is a simple short question. I think probably 3 questions into 5-15 marks. You know, like the question will be like, what is talent management? What is performance appraisal? And what is the difference between performance management? Right? What is the training need analysis method? How do you evaluate training evaluations? Like the small questions, which once I do it, I'll give you a typical question also to all of you guys. Then the C is a case study. Caselet on, I'm proposing, because I'm not the final authority. I'm giving 2-3 questions to the administration. They will decide which one. So I'm going to give a case study on performance appraisal, one on training and development, one on selection. 3 small 2-page caselet. Each caselet has got down 3-4 questions. Okay, that will be given to the administration and they will probably select randomly whichever one. So that second part of that 45 marks, it's purely in your hand. All of you know, you all experienced guys and also understood a lot of my way of talking and discussing. So that 45 marks is easily in your hand. Okay. And the first one also, that 15 marks, whatever you write, you'll end up getting 7 to 10, 12 marks. So now comes only the B part of it. No, it's a little more descriptive, little more applied. For example, how do you understand the prevailing employee engagement levels in industry today? Though we've not discussed about it, I'll give a brief about it. Or what kind of appraisal system you'll recommend for manufacturing industries as a service industry. So the same thing will be a little bit twisted in that kind of thing. But all those things, probable questions, I can probably share with you guys. So nothing to worry about. The overall, in 2 assignments, all of you have been graded very, very liberally. Okay. Now all put together, they'll combine into 100. I think 50% goes to your 2 assignments. 50% goes to your external examination. Out of 100 marks in external, they will take away 50. Out of this 30, 60, I think you have been graded for the 2 assignments. Out of 60, they will take 50. So they'll combine together. So going by that man, 2 assignments have already been graded. Most of you got, I think only very few people got 21, 22 for 2 late submission and things like that. And then this case study is going to be in your hand. I told you already case study is going to be on appraisal, training and development and this one. 1 or 2 guys write your mail ID. The final, once I finalize the case study, which I will do it maybe tomorrow, day after tomorrow, I'll also give you these other typical case studies like you to come. Enough? Have you answered your question?
Yes, Professor. Thank you.
Yes, Professor. Thank you.
Yeah, one or two guys.
Give sir, me Amit minute. Here.
Yeah.
Sir, Amit here.
Yes, Amit.
Sir, my assignment number 1 has not yet been graded.
Okay, tell me, I'll see that. Maybe, you know, that a lot of confusion, first group, then individual, then but your system is taking only individual. What's Amit, what is your this thing, group?
Section B, group 11.
Section B, group 11. I'll see it today itself. As soon as the class is over, I'll see it.
Please, sir. Thank you.
Section B, 11, right?
Yeah, I'll group 11,
you,
sir.
I'll tell you, it's already in my diary. I'll tell you guys.
It was submitted before the deadline, sir.
It is submitted now. Section B, group what's it? 11, huh?
Group 11, sir. Yes. Southwest
28 marks, right? Your group members got hot. 28, right?
Yes, sir. 28. They have got 28. Yeah.
I can see the sheet. It's written 28%. Okay. Oh, some of the mail ID, I want it in my WhatsApp. Guys are writing all mail ID. I want in WhatsApp. One or two guys, I send it, and then you can report it, all of you.
So I'm sending in sending my email ID in your personal WhatsApp, sir.
All right, that's more than.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, guys, all of you are back. Any questions on exam pattern? And I know sure it's easy for you. Cakewalk. Don't get into all the stress. And please, my request is don't write more, okay? Because I have to end up evaluating all your paper. So be brief, be concise, highlight points. That's my request to all of you guys.
Definitely, sir.
Okay. Let's not write too much. We are all professionals. We know not to write it too much of it. Right? You write to the point, that's more than enough. In fact, if given an opportunity, I could have made it even a, you know, open book or some exercise, some examples and things like that. Anyhow, the institute has to go through their own pattern. So write it specifically, crisply, short.
Any idea, Professor, how the invigilation will be? Because it will be online, so.
This I never thought about, my dear. Sorry. First question, I'm not able to answer your question. This only Arvind and I'm extremely sorry.
Okay.
I feel happy in answering all your questions, but this question I surrender, I cannot answer. Okay. Okay, man.
Sure.
Check up with Arvind.
There will be total 10 questions. Out of that, 8 we'll have to answer. How it will be, sir?
No, the section A, I think there are 4. You have to answer 3.
Okay.
Section B, I think there are 4. I thought that you have to answer 3. The case study, there will be in the bottom, there are 3-4 questions.
Mm-hmm.
This is the pattern.
Okay, sir.
Okay, nothing. I mean, the first section is simple theoretical kind of question, 3 questions, which you people will be able to write it. Which out of 15, I don't go into detail, between 8 to 12, the most of you will get it. Okay. And the case study, you know how to write it. You have a concept clarity, you will write it. Out of 45, you will definitely, people get 30 to 40 marks in case. Okay.
Sure, sir.
Now left out is only your the descriptive one. How it is going to evolve, I don't know myself. So these two things are strong and already your assignments are strong. So don't get into any of the stress. Enjoy life. Have a good concept, clarity. That's more than enough than exam at your level. Okay. Anything else on the exam patterns? Assignments, anybody not graded? Amit C. said, I will do it right now after the class is over. I've done by and large every lot of time it took you. Between individual, group, and when I asked you to put in group, you people rightly removed individual, but there is no way in LMS for individually group-wise giving a mark. Then I have to check, keep all the diary, check one by one. Finally, anyhow, I completed, I suppose. Okay, now can we come back to conclude our IR discussion or anything else you want to ask? Any questions you have other than our discussion topic today? Okay, then I'll come back. Now, like for example, we discussed about what are the general causes for dispute at length, right? We identified many causes, economical, organized, psychological, political, effectively handling all those kind of things. Many, many things we have taken out. Maybe the slide is taking care of it. Something slide has not come during your discussion. Similarly, there are many more than 10 acts applicable in labor law. Minimum Wages Act, Payment of Wages Act, Bonus Act, PF Act, ESI Act, Industrial Dispute Act, Gratuity Act, Compensation Act, many acts are there. But there are few acts which attracts major dispute. Major dispute. Those acts are 3. Payment of Wages Act, Industrial Dispute Act, Bonus Act. Again, I repeat, there are many acts. Bonus Act, ESI Act, Factory Act, Industrial Dispute Act, Contract Labor Act, Compensation Act, Workman Compensation Act. There are many acts out there. If you have to do labor law, I think some of your students are going to do specialization in labor law where you'll get into more detail about it. But there are three acts: Payment of Wages Act, Contract Labor Legislation, Abolition and Regulation Act, Bonus Act, Industrial Dispute Act. These are the four acts which attracts a lot of industrial disputes. Many issues are emerging out of these acts. Okay, again I'm repeating, Payment of Wages Act, Bonus Act, Contract Labor Abolition and Regulation Act, and Industrial Dispute Act. Is that clear? So that this you keep in mind. The other thing is, when we come with the examples, I hope you already done the demanding more bonus, asking fitment scale, not willing to implement DSA, demanding high. Okay, now tell me, it's a very important one. Then I'll get into the other one. There is a union, bankers union. They written an agreement with the government by force or by, not when say force, or influence or all those things, that hardship appointment, meaning by our sons or our ward should be given appointment after our retirement. Are you getting my point? Demanding hardship appointment. Most of the industries, they tried this kind of in the wage board settlement. They wanted to bring this class. When we retire or when we die, our ward means son or whosoever is eligible, to be given a job mandatorily. Not that we'll try to give you. They were putting a clause that you should give a job to my son or anybody else. So what is your understanding about this class? And there was a major issue about the clerical bank people also tried to manage to get this agreement signed, saying that their ward will be given a job in that part. What is your understanding? What do you know about this class? Then I'll talk you something about terminologies involved in this IR.
What I know of, sir, is that in case somebody is on active duty, which means that they have not yet they have not yet taken the VRS or they're still in duty. And if they lose their life while being on duty, then their kids, they are to be given a job. But otherwise, post-retirement, if somebody loses their life, then their kids, they don't get a job like something that they inherit from their parents.
In the IR itself, when they are trying, the union is putting pressure on you to sign an agreement in the wage board, they'll say, this is also one class they put. If they put a class saying that preference may be given to, you know, our wards based on the vacancy and suitability of our employee, that's fair enough. They tried to put a strict clause saying that they will be given a job. Even Bank Clerical Association managed to get this agreement done. Now, what you said is compassionate ground. It is called compassionate ground. On compassionate ground, somebody dies during the job. It's compassionate to give a job to that eligible employee of that company. That is very well settled, accepted also. Managerially accepted, legally accepted, court accepted, company management also accepted.
Correct.
It's unanimous. Nobody disputed that. Dispute comes when there is a dispute, right?
Yeah.
Compassionate appointment has been accepted by the management, by the court, by law, by employee, by everybody. But this thing, suppose somebody is saying that, or even managed to get an, because like for example, now the banks, you are dominating more on the technology. Maybe 20 years back, the dominance on clerical support was also too high, right? The bankers. Now last 20 years, maybe gradually got a lot of software, a lot of technology support, a lot of things. So they had a very dominant all over India union. So they could dominate, they could use their force, influence, persuasion, negotiation, bargaining. So they managed to get an agreement saying that our ward should be given employment. What is your take on that?
Essentially, depriving people of equal opportunity, if it just gets handed down from one person to their kids.
Okay.
So that goes against the constitution.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Rights.
Please go ahead. I want some perspectives from all of you. Then I'll tell you, it's a very interesting case. Finally, Supreme Court settled it. I'll also tell you the judgment of the Supreme Court, recent judgment. Now, what is your perspective?
So first thing, Professor, it should be based on eligibility criteria. And also, we should be at par with the legal framework.
Legally, what could be the framework? Yeah, they'll say that pay is gratuity, pay is PF, pay is notice salary, to all those things. Legally, can they say that give the job to the son? I don't think any act is there to say that. When somebody is retiring, death, forget about death, let's close that rule. In case of retirement, the act will say, pay pay is PF, pay is gratuity, pay is leave and cash salary, okay, pay is last month's salary. All those things, like there are acts, PF Act says, gratuity Act says, bonus Act says, all those kind of. I don't think any act says give this guy also job. So legally he's not entitled, right?
That's correct.
Not entitled. But some of the like bank employees union, they managed to get a job agreement done. So once agreement done, it's implementable. Okay. Now suppose you are sitting for a negotiation. You are involved in a large scale multi-union spread out political unions. In our, you already know, no, political union, Marxist approach. In the not your company to employ, it's a wage board kind of 20 steel industries. There's a steel industry All India level association. So All India level employers are signing with All Indian Employee Union. There they want to put up this class. My employee's son should be given a job. How will you deal that? They are putting pressure, negotiation, power, All India level, steel employee association. Maybe lakhs of employees are. Membership, they can go on a strike. They can close down all the steel industry for 10 days, 15 days a month. How will you handle this?
Sir, giving a job to what level? Unless we have a clear distinction.
No, somebody is retired. They say unskilled job. They say any job you give starting from unskilled. Even useless job also give me a job. But give me a job. Based on your vacancy, but not vacancy, based on my son's suitability, but you have to give a job. We are not bothered about your vacancies there.
But then we are starting answer, we are creating a discrimination. Why? Because we are not giving fair chance to any other participants who can fulfill that positions. Yeah, by virtue of possessing, being a ward or somebody's son or daughter, by virtue of that, automatic choice should not be given. So that's again.
That's a managerially. You are correct. Philosophically, managerially, what you are talking is relevance is absolutely right. But this guy, when they manage to put pressure All Indian level, you know, big Tikayat union, this union, that union, and the agreement is not one employer to one unit, it's an All Indian level unit. How will you handle it? Or even one individual employee versus a large industry, okay, a group of industry you have in one campus. There you have 5,000 employees. They're trying to put your this thing. Are you going to sign this agreement or I'll put the electricity, cut the electricity, cut the water? I'll not anyone allow officers to go out, go in.
Again, if it is not there in the clause and they're putting pressure to bring it in the clause, that needs a framework amendment is required. Once the framework amendment is required, then the whosoever the employer bound to follow. So we'll refer back to the court. It's one-way suggestions. We'll refer back. It's not there in the laws. We cannot take that into consideration.
Yeah. No, it is not in the act. All of you know that there's no law which says legally mandatory they have to be given a job. Even in the case of compassionate ground, there's no law. But people taken it. Okay, compassionate ground, we'll give it. But this, there is no.
We'll have to take it to court.
So we should not yield to that kind of agreement, right? But they did manage to get a signed in many industry, and even the banks, I'm telling you, Bank Clerical Association could get that agreement done. That is where Supreme Court has come into heavy power. You know what judgment Supreme Court has given? You will not imagine what Supreme Court said is that, you know, that giving an appointment to his own son is like you are inheriting your own empire. Under the fundamental rights, everybody has got an equal right to job, speak, express, and everything. Here, if X employee is working in that company, his son is going to get, why I'm an outsider, I'm losing my equal opportunity to get a job in that company. Similar judgment given by now, Supreme Court, Najaw. The farmer strike is going on. Initially, Supreme Court said, okay, you have the right to express. You have a fundamental right to express. Now, later, Supreme Court said, you can express, but you cannot cut the other's fundamental right of disturbing the road for a long time. You have a fundamental right to go on strike. You have the fundamental right to speak. You can express this, but there is a limit by which you don't curtail the other's fundamental right. Similar example, judgment court by the Supreme Court here. hardship appointment is not maintainable, even if it is signed by any agreement under the influence, it's ultra vires, null and void, because this cuts the fundamental right of equally qualifying candidates trying and getting a job. You through pressure, through your own empire you are building. So hence, under the fundamental right, this kind of agreement is against the law, against the fundamental right given the constitution. Hence, this kind of agreement becomes ultra vires and null and void. That class has helped a lot of our industries. Otherwise, still a lot of big industries where the manpower was used to be high, like for example, Tata Steel kind of industry. Too much of people, too many union. What will they do? Okay, we'll say, okay, we yield to that kind of thing. The Supreme Court judgment has come a long way in getting it. Is that clear to all of you guys?
I've explained. When was this judgment came, sir? If I...
Sorry?
When was this judgment recently?
No, it's very old, 10, 12 years back.
All right.
10, 12 years back. But it was a mind-boggling judgment. All of you think that's a very good judgment, right? So now nobody can interfere. Now no union can ask you to sign an agreement. Even if you sign an agreement, that agreement is not valid. But this was a killing class in the most of the, you know, the adamant union guys, na? Militants. We will use the word militant. Militant kind of union guys will try to do all those kind of things. Okay, clear now? Any example you want to ask how the IR situation can be handled? Otherwise, I want to explain you some terminology. Any example, any ideas, any experience you gone through or you want to explain or you want me to explain? Like I explained you bonus issue, I explained you moral allowances, I explained you fitment scale, I explained that not willing to implement ESI, hardship appointment. So these are the few cases I thought I'll explain it to you guys so that you get a feel of actual handling with a fire, not only really theoretically talking. Any other examples you want it or you have in mind?
Not in this context, in a general sense, I'm professor, just out of curiosity. This union thing were prevalent, mostly dominant, Kerala, West Bengal, Tripura, way back in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Of late, we have seen a reduction in it. So, can we not get rid of this cancer issue?
What reduction you are saying?
How reduction in the sense, no, reduce in a sense, because of union, a lot of factories got closed down, right? Now, people have
People were not willing to invest in that kind of state, you know, that they lost a lot of industries.
Correct.
So Kerala means nobody would come to invest in that industry.
Right. So, off late, people have understood that this unionized will not help in the progressive way. This is a regressive way. However, this to safeguard the interest of the workers and all, probably the law can be tweaked a little less, not a toothless one, probably. But then this itself is an issue. If you see this union thing, if the external forces are there, union is rightly required, as you mentioned. If it is understand between the employer and the industrial IR, the relationship. But when an external force comes into play, then the whole the narrative gets changed, the purpose gets changed and all. So yeah. Can we not get rid of it in the longer run or days to follow? Do you foresee any such events?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. I'll explain in detail. Anybody like to give perspective to his question? Very interesting one. I will explain. I'll give you my perspectives based on my 40 years of experience in various states. So of course, I have not directly worked in Kerala. I worked in UP, Punjab, Gujarat, all those states. I worked really extensively. But anyhow, I'll give you. Anybody would like to give a perspective to this one? His question is that while we fully recognize trade union is important, we also want them to play an integral role. But at the same time, they are trying to be ruthlessly killing that industry in the name of playing trade union for a selfish reason. Should we not control it? Why we have not controlled in the past? Why we should not control no more? Have I repressed your question correctly?
Correct. And where do we see in light of like 10 years down the line? Is it going to be more aggressive or whatever? Because this is a regressive thought process. Now, even a lot of people, I hear both the sides of the story. Now, government is selling the PSU, selling this. Now, privatization, is it good or bad? Obviously, government is doing a good, if I see the Western economy, how they are developing by privatizations, how reducing the dependency on the government itself, they are going to be. So it's a lot of both sides. The debate can happen. Correct. So the more privatization, more or we see less dependent on these unions and all. Correct.
Correct. Now you asked two questions. The first question, let me settle the first question, right? I'll come to this one, right? Have you understood? You asked two questions, two different questions.
Totally.
All right. Okay. The first one is that, yes, I will give my own perspective. There has always been a good intention of creating and allowing a trade union. Okay. The role allotted to trade union was very correct, saying that look after the employees' grievances, negotiate with the employer so that they get the best kind of things. The intention, the role, the documentation has always been excellent. Nothing wrong in it. Now, when they come to put pressure, undue pressure, it could have been controlled. Like I said, unitary approach, pluralistic approach, or Marxist approach. When they got into Marxist approach to gain a political kind of things, the guys who are the law implementer have been the worst enemy of this one. Had there been the chief minister or the ministers or anybody wanted to implement the Trade Union Act in the spirit of it, not allowing them to get into the Marxist approach or not allowing through them the political gain, they could have been put into control then also, there now also, future also. Now we lost heavily in the name of social justice, in the name of allowing, in the name of selfish getting a political gain through this trade union. So in the past also, the act was correct, intention was correct, the document was correct, the role in mark was correct. The way it was implemented, they totally, suppose they say, you don't cross the red signal. If you cross it, still you don't do it, what will happen? You should be caught and fined and put jail or whatever like that. Nah? So when the trade union people, like right now court said, like for example, you cannot have a hardship appointment, or the court says you cannot misuse that kind of thing, or somebody, either court should have come down heavily. Now court is also very, very dominantly using the judicial review, or more than the court, how come these guys could use more teeth? Not the trade union political guys, all the packer cup, all the big guys, political heads, chief minister, prime minister, whosoever was involved, they were packing it up. So since they were seeing from the political point of view, they were dividing and ruling, killing the industry. Now off late, since a lot of educated people are coming, media's come into picture, they thought too much of this, and the people themselves are also educated. They don't want this kind of, in the past, people were also not, you know, very much clear about both perspectives. People used to say, oh, trade union people are doing good thing. We are making us to give, get the best of them. They are not understanding, get like for example, how many industry you lost it? How many employment opportunity you lost? The people say, most of the people, they go out of Kerala, from within India or outside India to look for a job. But had it been an industry inside, why they would have gone for it? So now the question was, intention of the act, trade union, then was right, now also right. Implementation, the law implementing authority themselves joined with them, they themselves involved in the gundagiri. Had it have been controlled, now there is no choice, they have to control, because if they don't control, the media will not allow, or even the public themselves are allowed with this thing, even the state government GDP will go down. So down the line, and the government, central government also coming forward in, you know, safeguarding the industry. Previously, they are more into capitalistic mind. Socialistic mind, too much. No, we don't want capitalists to exploit that kind of. Our countries, what is that one? Sovereign socialistic country, starting with that one. Okay, that time it must be the right one. Now, if you don't allow business to flourish. So definitely, they started talking about changing of the labor law, liberalization of labor law, simplification of labor law. Now, you know, if you can reduce lot many inspector checking, all those things, they are doing it. Had they done it in the past, it would not have come. And similarly, whenever trade union people are going beyond illegal strike and all, they should have taken it action. So by doing it, they have to do it. If they don't do it, there's no more time in allowing them. I don't think any industry, any state is going to that level now. It will be under control. First answer to your question. The second question you asked is that, should the public sector industries be run by government or should be privatized? Am I right? Have I understood your question?
Correct. The more we privatize it, the less we are dependent on the union again.
They can handle it. Yeah, the political involvement will come. Yeah, you are absolutely right. Then government companies, again, the political power is more by those companies. So if it is privatized, still we can find ways and means of handling this, guys. So we can also get some ministers to handle it, right? That's how I used to do. In worst places like UP and all, staying there, when they can go to minister, even I used to go to minister to handle it, labor minister and everybody, to handle that issues. Now, the question is that should the public sector be given to privatized sector, all the more to handle the labor, large scale industry where labor is largely involved and the government is not able to handle the labor union, should it be given to the private sector? Comments from other members. I'll again answer. As usual, I'll answer my question, this thing. I'll give my opinion, but I want others' opinion. The question is clear to all of you guys, right?
Yeah, private sector, sir, it is more accountable. Government, it is accountable, though CAG and all audits happens, but then we don't see any anything. This die down in the paper. So private sector...
See, government, my major role should be more concentration on health, education, roads, infrastructure, that kind of development kind of work. All
more
this
business, the governance on this.
Governance and the development board, all the running the businesses and industry, which needs functional autonomy, which needs decision-making authority. By being a government, you get stuck up with the process itself. You get stuck up in the bureaucratic process itself. So you are not able to handle it. So the industry's business should be, in my opinion, should be handed over to private sector, unless some very sensitive industries there. You are making some, you know, defense parts or something which you don't want to disclose, that kind of thing. That's fair and understandable. Other than that sensitive kind of industry, all the industry should be given to private sector because they have the functional autonomy. They can take a decision. They can invest. They can sell. They do. Whereas government cannot do it. Politically, they are covered in many ways. So in my opinion, government should concentrate more on development, education, getting a proper education, good education, health issues, roads, infrastructures, external relationship development, getting a good governance of practical policies and process, single window system for making the business to grow. All those areas government should concentrate. Doing the business, we should give it to private sector. This is my opinion. Anybody would like to object to that or give a different opinion, you're most welcome.
So another view to it, given the fact that if we hand it over to the private sector, now private sector automatically they needs fund. Governments, they will pump on their own or a suitable mechanism. But when they need a funds to run it, because the moment you are giving it private sector year on year, they will set the target for their revenue increase and so on.
Obviously,
and so
obviously,
forth, right?
Obviously.
And
obviously,
the moment you are opening up the channel of getting a funds from the private equity or something else, then you are opening up channel, a lot of potential player available.
Correct.
And how do you see a challenge? Do you see a challenge, say, for example, if Chinese companies are investing money there and trying to take a control over a period of time by virtue of having a wealthier nation, how do you foresee any challenges from that perspective?
See, that you have to address one problem first. First problem is our business and economy should do well. Now the public sector enterprises, they are making huge loss. Government is diverting fund from some other places to take care of the losses. How long you can use that kind of money till? Private sector.
That's true. We have seen for Indian Airlines as well. They were
they are diverting money, taxpayers' money, or that money could have been used somewhere else for some good purpose. That is getting diverted. How long you can do it? Yes, that should stop. There is no two opinion about it. Second thing, the private sector, they will, when they see it, they will immediately revive it. They will also take the government schemes, funds and incentives available. But they will try to revive by not only getting fund, they'll go for automation. They'll come up with some side product. Like a lot of industries, the main product has become a five product. You know, they amalgamated with many other products. So they will think, they will quickly decide. They'll get a best technology. They'll come up with many other products added to the main product. In many industries, the main product has become a five product. From sugar, pulp, paper, alcohol, mixing alcohol with petrol. You know, many things happens. So these guys will look for an innovation, will survive through technology, through fund arrangement, through size cutting, through collaboration, all those things he will do. So that is needed not only for him, for the economy, for the country, for the industry to grow. Okay. So now you have a governance to control him, na? In case he does anything wrong. So I totally agree with that kind of.
Yeah, government role should be governance. To the private sector.
Governance and the development. And the development, taking care of the development. Okay. Yeah. Okay, guys. So now there are one or two points I like to say. Now, there's another one. There are some, this activity expert. There are some few terminologies which creates a lot of problem in IR. when people are getting out of the job, there are different ways. One is retiring people, right? There's no dispute about it. When they retire, you'll pay them the gratuity, you'll pay them the whatever on leave and all those things. It's not an issue. When people resign, also not a problem. You resign, you give the notice period, you take your whatever gratuity and everything like total. Third, people not resign, but they are forcibly getting resigned in the sense they are sick, long time absence, 3 months, 6 months, 1 year. And finally, it's like a forced resignation. Okay, that is also not a problem. I said retirement, no problem. As per the standing order or the court order, 58 or 60 or 62, whatever the standing order or the retirement age. Resignation is your own wish and will. Or the absenting from job due to ill health and all those things. Beyond certain time, it's a sort of post-resignation goes. There is two more words which is really creating problem is called layoff and retrenchment. Okay. What do you mean by retrenchment? What do you mean by layoff? While finally you are closing the employee relationship through the cessation of service, the cessation of service, three issues I explained to you, which all of you know. Retirement, resignation, or forced resignation due to abstinence from job for a long time due to sickness or whatever you call it. Or you left the country or whatever you did. You are absenting from job. It's like a resignation. So now there are two more issues called layoff and retrenchment. What do you mean by layoff? What do you mean by resignation?
Laying off is to bring down the cost control, to manage the cost. So layoff where production, where the requirement is, we have a human resource or the labors where more numbers as opposed to not required to produce or produce whatever productions or requirements. So there calls for a layoff from a company perspective to balance it off in terms of managing funds. And am I going right, Professor? Or,
okay, go ahead.
A reduction or... Redundant employees should go off. Retrenchment.
No, that's not there. Okay, anyway, you've made a good attempt. What about others? Yeah, please, he only talking all the time. Come on, guys. Santosh, you are there. What do you mean by retrenchment, Santosh? Pavan, Santosh, Srikant, Ajay. Come on, guys, tell me. Gautami, Amit Kumar, Kotresh, all these guys, tell me, what do you mean by layoff? What do you mean by retrenchment? Attempt, make an attempt. I'll definitely tell you. I'll conclude, don't worry. Make an attempt. He said retrenchment is redundant implies to be this one. No, yeah, it's generally correct, but it has to be more specific, I'll tell you. Layoff also is given his perspective.
Retrenchment could be layoffs only, but because of some... because to reduce the cost, reduce some expenses of the company because of that.
Retrenchment or layoff?
Retrenchment. It's layoff, but because of the, because you have to reduce the expenses, because you have to reduce the cost of the company, you are doing the layoffs.
Okay, that is one part of it.
Layoffs are typically cost-cutting measures. For me, retrenchment is like we shut down one unit or one side of our business. Then maybe that is retrenchment.
Yeah, you are coming quite closer to the answer. Okay. Yeah. Come on, some more guys.
So retrenchment is possibly an act where a company, decides to shut down a certain, unit because of the economic factors that are out there, Professor.
Right, to a large extent, correct.
Yeah, and layoff, is getting rid of the employees just because of certain reorg or, misbehaviors or, cost-cutting measures. It's just a termination of employment, where it is not employee-initiated, but an employer-initiated.
Okay. Good point. Then all of you should understand the six words very clearly, which could be a very good reason for industry dispute. Okay. Now, anybody like to add? You raised one more point, termination of employee. We talked about retirement, which doesn't need any explanation. Resignation doesn't need an explanation. The third one, absconding from a job, thereby getting the you are resigning compulsory. That also doesn't require. Three things require things: termination, layoff, and retrenchment. Three things doesn't need any explanation: retirement, resignation, compulsory sickness resignation. Three doesn't need it. The other three thing is layoff, termination, and retrenchment. Okay, termination means you cannot terminate an employee unless you give a charge it, get an explanation, get an inquiry conducted, like a court. Somebody killed somebody. The court cannot say, oh, this guy is killed somebody, hang him. He has to be taken into custody. Charge it has to be issued. Inquiry will start place. Investigation will take place. Witnesses will be cross-verified. Issues will be framed. Argument, counter-argument will take place. Finally, the judgment will come, saying that, yes, this guy has proved to have committed the mistake. Even then, they will not say what punishment to be given. Well, again, that goes for appeal or whatever reason. So finally, doing all those things, the punishment is given by the amount of offense proved. Similarly, termination needs to be done by giving a charge. Okay. Then after giving a charge, then you issue an explanation. Then all those things. If you complete all those things, it says termination is completed as per the social justice required, as per the natural justice required. If it is not done this way, under the Dispute Act, Industrial Dispute Act, employee can go and get all the back wages. Back wages mean, by the time, suppose you dismiss somebody 10 years back, by the time he goes to different court, you go to labor court, you go to high court, you go to Supreme Court, all those kind of things. It may take even 10 years for the final judgment. Suppose Supreme Court or High Court says, no, your termination is wrong, illegal. Termination, the court will never say that, why did you terminate? You know, he has stolen it, not stolen it. The court will not get into that. His integrity or misbehavior, court will not question that. Have you complied with the natural justice of charging, referencing, indexing, all those things? Have you done it? If you've done it, yes, approved. In case after 10 years, the court says, no, your termination is wrong. You have to pay all 10 years back wages and install him again in the current job. Are you getting it? So termination is not an easy one. You are allowed. You can do it, provided you act very smartly. Hire an advocate, charge it him. Most of the guys, you are all may not be aware of all this thing. This is major nuisance in industries, factories. So you have to invest time in terminating people. Okay, that's clear. Now, layoff is, suppose, now through the pandemic, I'm manufacturing, so I'm not able to get raw material. I have three plants. One plant have to be shut down. I don't know when I'll be able to start. So I'm temporarily laying you off from coming to work as I don't have raw material, or I'm not able to sell the finished product, which is filed up. There's no place for me to produce and keep the finished product. I'm telling, laying off means I laying you off temporarily for a period of 3 months or 6 months. I may pay minimum, 2 months salary or some subsistence allowance as per the act, as per the Industry Dispute Act. And I may resume it after 3 months, 4 months. Till the time I let, so the relation between you and me as an employee and employer is continuing, temporarily suspended. Till you not resign, I have not suspended, I only suspended our employee-employee relationship temporarily for a month or two or three or four or five, six. Okay, our relationship continues. Whereas, is that clear? Laying off means, like right now you take, I have three plants, one plant I am not able to manufacture. I don't have raw material, or whatever I produce, I'm not able to sell. So what will I do with you guys? So I'm laying you off for 1 month. So you have to give proper notice to the government, get the approval of the government, and then lay you off is a layoff. What is retrenchment? Retrenchment is, suppose you have, again, the same example, three units, three production shelter, two is working, one I don't have a raw material, I don't have finance, and the technology has become not feasible, the product is not acceptable in the market, so I've decided to close down that one unit permanently. Okay, by and large. So there in layoff, it's a temporary. In the retrenchment, the layoff, I don't pay any compensation. I pay only 1 or 2 months, whatever salary, some subsistence. In this retrenchment class, I primarily decided to close permanently. When I decide to close, how will I deal with the employee? Not a retirement, not a resignation, not forced resignation, not termination. So when you say the retrenchment, the meaning says, retrenchment means it is not termination. it is not retirement, it is not resignation, it is not forced resignation, it is not all that. Then what it is? It is, I am closing down the business for economic reason, economic viability, number one. I am taking the permission of the government, number two. Number three, I am using the procedure of last come, first go. If I have 300 people, I need to retrench 100 people. Whosoever joined last, those people will go. Three. Four, I have to pay retrenchment compensation. That is 15 days of salary per, suppose the guy worked for 15 years. I have to pay 15 years, 15 days of salary, plus his gratuity, plus his leave encashment. All those things have to be paid and calculated. And thereby, by and large, I am closing my relationship with him as an employer-employer. Though there is one clause, in case future I start the plant, which never takes place, I have the duty to inform that guy, will you be interested in coming and joining with the new terms? Is it clear to you guys? Retrenchment means I have three plants. One plant I want to shut down because of economic viability. So I take the permission of the government. I cannot do it on my own. I have to get prior permission of the government. Last come, first go. Those out of 100, 300 people, who's over 50, the last come who has come, I have to pay them the compensation. Retrenchment compensation, 15 days per year of service done. Not to be done, already done. To be done, nothing we pay. And plus, there's gratuity, leave encashment, all those things to be paid. And thereby, relationship comes to an end. If at all, anything I start in the future, I have a moral duty to give an opportunity to that guy may accept it or not accept it. So retrenchment is not termination. Retrenchment is not retirement. Retirement is not layoff. Retirement not resignation. Retrenchment is retrenching because economic viability. One, there is one more very complicated, which I don't want to tell you. There are some confidential positions like your security guard, your accountant. I lost confidence in that guy. So if I go to terminate him, it will take a lot of procedure. I can take a class in retrenchment. This is a confidential post. A cashier, my personal security guard. No, will I go through, charge it and do all those things? I lost confidence in that guy. Yeah. My security guard is supposed to take care of my life. Now, if you say that I have to terminate him, I have to go through, charge it and to prove that it's intentional, it's wrong. So I lost confidence. So the post is a confidential nature. So there are smartly people like me, wherever I wanted to throw people, termination is very difficult. So it retrench the people in the retrenchment class, let him go and challenge the court. So you, but that guy should have been in that post like security guard or a cashier. You know, the guy should be in such a post, you try and prove he was in a very confidential, very critical position. So I cannot take any chance of going through the termination class. And so I am retrenching it through this retrenchment class. That's very, very rare case. You don't get confused with that. I used it once or twice. But retrenchment, what I explained to the first one, that's fair enough. Have you understood now all the five? Layoff, termination, retrenchment, all the three you understood it? The other three to clear. Retirement, resignation, forced resignation, it's clear, nothing to worry about. These three is clear to your guys or not? Layoff, termination, retrenchment. I want yes or no from you guys. Clear or not clear?
Yes, sir.
Any question on this? It's absolutely clear. Huh? Layoff, retrenchment is up. Because you guys are in modern, so you may not be getting to know of layoff retrenchment. This is what layoff retrenchment. It comes under the Industrial Dispute Act. That is why I told you, there are hundreds of acts. 3-4 acts comes heavily in IR. So you should be thorough in this 3-4 act. Contract Labor Abolition and Regulation Act, Industrial Dispute Act, Payment of Wages Act, Bonus Act. These 3-4 acts will account for 70-80% of industrial dispute issues, based on my own experience. Okay, that is where I thought this terminology should know clearly, this one. The other one, I want a simple request from all of you guys. These are, I hope most of you must be having slides here up, right? All of you have slides here off for application or not? Hello guys, I'm asking you. There is an application called slide share.
No sir, I'm not having.
Not having, please download that one. In that one, you go to this, whatever I've written, it's not small, what is employee engagement, what is high performance organization, write down employee engagement PPT, you'll get to know. I want you to read it, all those concepts, because it's a very important one to know, since we don't have time to cover all this thing, but you guys can easily understand. You just download it.
Application in mobile or in
anywhere you can go in mobile, you can get to the laptop anywhere you can. I think by and large it's in the slides in mobile. iPad or mobiles.
Okay.
You can try right now. Now you see slide share.
All right.
Get just now right now try now.
Yeah, trying sir.
Write and then write it employee engagement PPT. We'll get to know. Best employer PPT, PCMM PPT, high performance organization PPT. I just want you guys to read all those things. This is are the temporary terminology which is being overtalked in the industry. I don't want my students not be aware of this. Most of you must be aware, but go through some of the PPTs. Could you lay your hands on that? Employee engagement, Hewitt study, best employer India, US, Canada, people capability maturity model, Wipro is PCMM 5 level, competency mapping, HPO's high performance organization, organization development and change management. These are the few concepts I wanted to read.
Oh, sir, there are a lot of employee engagement. If I see one,
take anyone.
Okay.
Take any, just to have a fair idea about what do they talk about. You are all mature guys. I don't want you to get into too much academic. You should know the fairly what is the literary and contextual meaning of employing. There may be many people may suppose it. You pick anyone, just go through it.
Okay.
Similarly, I want you to go through on best employer. PCMM, Wipro, anybody is from Wipro?
I rendo sisila anti kadar khayega.
So PCMM is in Wipro, right? PCMM 5, right? People capability maturity model. There's an HR approach. There are 5 models they give. So I want you to guys, please go through all those things. Just 1 hour, 2 hour, you go through whenever. It'll be interesting. Sir. High performance organization, I want you to go through.
Sure, sir.
OD and change management, I want you to go through. Safety and harassment, a lot of you and cry is taking. A lot of committees and circles are taking place these days. These are the modern concept which is being overtalked in the industry, which I want you to guys to read. I hope you'll read it, right?
Yes, sir.
Because if you want to get it, you'll take another one full class to go into that. But I'm sure you'll be able to read.
So this PPT is not available in LMS.
What, this employee engagement and all, or what I'm doing today?
No, IR.
That I load it. Not, I could not all give it. I'll give it. This PPT is not in available LMS. Today morning only I concluded, so I will give it.
All right.
Okay. Today I'll make Arvind to upload it. Okay, guys. Are you clear about now IR framework? As a generalist, are you absolutely clear about IR after this 3 hours spending? How do you rate yourself, your knowledge, understanding about IR? The implication of IR, understanding the scope, dimension, the complexity of IR. If I have to ask you to write a paper or deliver a lecture on IR, how competent are you guys to deliver a lecture or write a paper on it?
Truly, Professor, we received a lot of insights we were not having before this session particularly.
Otherwise, it would look like a too abstract kind of things. No, you will run away by hearing the word IR and ER, right?
Yeah.
I used to do it long back. 30 years back, I used to run away. Oh, what is it, IR? What is ER? But it's not nothing like it. It's simple logic, simple 2 + 2 = 4. So you people will be able to talk or write and understand and conceive this IR and ER issues. And all the more needed for you guys because you are not, most of you are not into factory level kind of work. So you will never get a chance to learn. The factory people probably will get a chance, but you are more into the other kind of career or corporate sector where this kind of things may or may not be there to a large extent. Okay, guys, any other questions you want to ask? Can I ask you these questions in your question, short questions? What is employee engagement? Define best employer, define PCMM and all. If I write, will you be able to handle it?
Yes, Professor, we'll read and we'll handle it.
I understand. Yeah, please do that because it looks a little nicer to ask this kind of questions.
Sure, Professor.
Okay, I want you guys to read. Yes, Amit Pfizer. Amit Pfizer is there. Okay, guys, any questions you want to ask, please go ahead. We have another 10 minutes. Anything related to this subject?
Your answer.
Yeah. Hello?
No, sir, definitely. Once again, I need to go through this excerpts of this session.
Yeah.
Only I'll be more
No problem. Even otherwise, if people are, I'm in LinkedIn, man, anything on your professional career, do you have my LinkedIn idea? Right? Dr. Sole Bhaskaran, I'm in LinkedIn. You are all professional guys. I'll be more happy to associate with you guys. As much as I don't know whether you are happy to associate, I'll be happy to associate with you guys. Anything on professional level, you're most welcome. In the LinkedIn, you see my name, Dr. Sole Bhaskaran. Okay. I'm more into HR, IR, as a CEO, more into education, pharma, sugar, chemical, alcohol industries. I'm also getting PhD students. I'm also PhD examiner of PhD student. I'm also lawyer. Okay, this is my simple profile, small profile. From bottom to top to bottom, anything? Dimensions we have seen. Causes, importance. This causes the we generated more than what you written. I don't know. Even if you ask me back, I'll not be able to remember and tell you. You guys only made me to come up with some more causes. What could be the causes? And what should be the approaches we understood? And all basically one word, be proactive, be pragmatic, be clean, go clean-handed as an employer. Don't yield to them. Be confident. It's all two generic words. Now you can understand the two generic words. If somebody gives beginning the lecture IR, it should be too confident, too proactive. It looks like a too theoretical word. Now after listening all those things, it makes sense, right? You have to be proactive. You have to be confident. You don't yield to them. You are clean. Then your IR, you are able to handle it properly. And you are complying with acts. Handle effectively union. Have an absolute command over the understanding of the act. Implement the act thoroughly. Don't allow anybody's of ifs and buts, because ignorance of law is not an excuse. And we also discussed at length about many this thing. And out of that, I said there are many acts. Be careful. Wages Act, Contract Act, Bonus Act, all this act. Some terminology we talked about. Then, and the best practices you have to pick up. This is what we covered today. Any questions, my dear? Anything? Not only today's class, last few classes, or anything concerned your career? Or you can give me a job, yeah, all of you. Why are not guys giving me a job, yeah? Hello?
Sir, you are in a better position, sir.
I'm in a better position. So this is a smart answer.
After three more semesters, we'll be asking you only, professor, for that sentence.
No problem. So you guys become more smarter after talking to me. That so that to cut him into the first, effectively you are handling me, right? Saying that, just put the professor firstly in the right. Sir, we cannot do a job. Correct? Good, I'm happy. I'll tell you, coming to job, yeah. Be confident, get the right certificate course, keep the concept clear. There is no depth of jobs available in any career, I can tell you. Some of you only, your industry, your group, other group, the other say, somebody approached me, sir, I have a vacancy for some HR guy 3-4 post. I know how difficult to appoint people. It's difficult to get people, whichever field, but you be one among the generalists, we call in product, me too product. I'm also product, then you are gone. You brand yourself. You equip yourself. You get the right certificate for yourself. Like, for example, when you go for immigration, Canadian immigration, I have a PhD, but there's a class for English communication, 10 marks. Even your PhD, that guy gives zero. But if you clear IT, you know, what is that? TOEFL or what?
IELTS.
Huh? IELTS, he will give you 10 marks. You understand? He's the customer, right? If I say, sir, I'm a PhD from IIT, bloody hell, you want me to prove my English? You better give me 10 marks. He will not give you. If I clear IELTS, he will give you 10 marks. So like this, you guys get a right certificate, right knowledge, right kind of reading. Nobody in the earth can stop you from your career, I can tell you. Most people are not utilizing their potentiality, or they don't know how to go about it. In fact, I stood one of the firm to take care of all guys like that, how you can propel yourself.
But currently, there is a lot of job dearth due to this ongoing pandemic, sir.
That's all temporary. Even here, people are not getting people here. You think that people have to survive, right? Indian economy has to grow. How long we can go with pandemic?
I'm telling you,
till last week, I traveled here. This is the only week I have not traveled. I'm urging to travel. I've already taken 2 doses. Okay, I am very careful wearing N95 mask, two mask. I wear gloves and carry sanitizer. You have to carry on, right?
Yeah.
How long you can say in the name of pandemic, people will die otherwise. Economically, no food, no growth. And the like I told you, my own sister company, they made 20 crores in this pandemic period. Yeah. The best, ours one branch is best pharma company where we are struggling to survive because we are not able to get medicine and supply due to pandemic. The other subsidy we started with all same thing, multivitamins, vitamin C in a different topa, or something called, you know, like your mask, N95 mask or sanitizer or different multi nutraceuticals, whey protein, all those things we promoted last 1 year, that branch has touched 20 crores turnover. You can see it in the net, bold bit. So thrive in chaos. There is a book called Thrive in Chaos. You cannot just relax. While sitting at home, you enjoy relaxing, do exercise, and also constructively do something. You can read, write, equip. Today I'm talking, why? Because my knowledge, right? My qualification, my knowledge, right? Whatever I studied, learned, I picked up everywhere, that goes along with you. So while sitting at home, like for example, people like me, either I can say I'm going mad, I'm not going out. Or I can be sit at home, sit in a nice home, start writing a book. Who stops me in writing a book, tell me? Nobody, right? Or who stops me in writing the best 10 articles from Harvard Business? So be proactive. Don't get into the myth there is less job. You are confident. You are the leader. You are the intrapreneur. And this time also, you use it. If you waste your time, it's your headache. I'm not saying, asking you to go to the, you have better opportunity, man. Everything's available in the net. Go through various site HR, there's one good forum. Foreign university. I'm not getting that. Lot of materials are available. MOOC is there. How many people heard about MOOC? MOOC, MOOC. MOOC is a big platform, all the best of the universities in the world. They are promoting all the courses. Many of the courses are free. Some of the courses are highly paid and very well recognized. Enroll yourself in MOOC for some of the relevant courses for you. Equip yourself now. Your time should not get wasted sitting at home. This is how I drive my son also. He studied from Toronto, his MBA. But even now I say that don't waste your time. Do some course. Is it sensible? Sloan School of Management. Sloan School of Openware course, you get a lot of courses freely available. MOOC, MOOC, MOOC courses are available. Digital marketing is picking up. Go through Google's or you go through finance guys going to CFR, not Chartered Accountancy, which is very well closely recommended. HR guys go through SHRM certificate. All while having time, do it. Go to the market. So your application should be one among lakhs. Everybody comes with MBA, you are one among one. You are with MBA, your communication is good, you have experience. Also, you have two certificate courses related to that. Who will stand better? Which industry will not like to touch? Am I talking sense or nonsense, guys? You'll say that
yes, professor. Has, sure.
The professor has gone mad, he's talking like that.
No, professor.
It really makes a difference.
I'm not saying don't enjoy, don't relax. Do everything. Enjoy, relax, whatever. But have that 3-4 hours. Have I done anything constructively? Have I read? Am I working towards my development? Am I increasing my value day by day? I create value in me, then only I can, you know, discharge the value to the customer or consumer. They are willing to take your value. Provided you keep on adding your value. I know you are a valuable person, one among the lakhs. But that is not an end to it. Add value. Keep on adding value. This is how I took it, even at this stage. I've decided to read I don't read any of the articles from in any other institute. I read only HPR. I made it a standard. I'll read only HPR. Because I want to be very careful in my time. I don't want to waste my time in reading something and then not gaining it. But at least I want, my wife is good taskmaster. She says, oh, this month you have not studied. How many HPR you read? How many good new books you studied? Mind you, I'm at the age of 65 now. So you just keep on adding to your level, right? I can spend my time with only my old laurels talking, no. But I want to be up to date and beat those Harvard guys. That is the spirit you should keep it. Okay, guys? Okay, yeah. All the best. Anything else you want to ask, ask. I hope I'm not bored you at the end, concluding speech.
No, sir. No. It is a motivational.
Surely not.
Yeah. And you can do it. And nothing difficult.
Yes,
sir. Only thing is you are not thinking seriously. Thinking is a difficult job, I'll tell you. To me, it's also thinking a job. And how to go about it? You can do it or you can consult somebody. That is another success, big success factor in your life. Excuse me. How to go about it? If I know, I'm whichever line, in 5 years, these are the prospects available. This is the kind of competition. Now, if I go with this kind of certificate course, this kind of competition, I will definitely stand a better chance. Correct? So whether you take it like what you call complacency, okay, it's going, running, compare, what is that? It's a lockdown period, let me use it properly. No, even without lockdown also, complacency. I did my engineering, I did my MBA, enough fit. This is not enough, this is only a starting point. For your kind of age and all, the whole world is in your hand. And anything is difficult, what I'm saying, tell me. Identifying a course, enrolling in a course, completing that course. Is it difficult for any one of you? Tell me.
No, professor.
No, basically your attitudes, right? Thinking. Nothing is difficult because you already achieved so far in life. You cleared all those 10th standard, 12th standard, degree, engineering. It was not an easy. You completed many things. Now it is relatively easy for you. When you look back to your past, whatever you are going to do is relatively easy. Only thing is now you got into complacency. Shake your complacency. Think, work out a target. Like you're working for a company also, no? You're meeting their KPI. You are working through the metrics and scorecard. But you are not developing. Strategically, you are not investing in you, in your time, in your own growth. And you have the potentiality. If you don't have the potentiality, don't tax yourself. I'm not telling that guys don't have the potentiality. Why should tax you? Enjoy. I'm the guy who believes in a lot of enjoyment. Best of the life. Buy best of the thing. Wear all branded ones. Use all branded ones. Enjoy life to the hilt. Spend money right and left. At the same time, this is all possible when you do all other things. You are developing, you are grooming, you are certifying. You should be notified one among the, this is a different guy. And that is nothing difficult. It's not a rocket science. If you know how to go about it, you are through. I wish all of you start working. One thing, to be specific, based on the lecture, what is the hands-on? How to get started? Today is 2021. By 23, I must start 2 relevant certificate courses, which will be accepted by all the multinationals in the world. Can I identify? Can I start enrolling? Can I start studying? Is it possible or not possible? Tell me.
Possible, professor.
Is whether it's CFA, whether it is digital marketing, whether it is IoT kind of things, whether it's digital science, whatever, decision making, whatever analytics, predictive, descriptive, whatever. And be careful that don't get into without doing a thorough exercise, don't jump into it. Do a course which will be, like I said, IELTS may or may not be big, but it's understood by that guy. So do what the industry wants. Get that kind of certificate. So industry guy, if I'm an HR director, I will like to immediately see only that kind of CV. Oh, this guy got a certificate. All other guys, who's got time to go through it? Throw that into the spin. 1 minute. Elevator pitch. Have you heard about elevator pitch? Going the elevator takes few seconds, right? In that few seconds itself, I should be able to see your CV. Or even in your interview. And that is easy if you start preparing now onwards. Like getting started, I said. And decide within a week, consult to you, me, or anybody, professional association, understand what is going to be the future, my 5 years. If I have to reach that plump post 5 years, why can't I reach in 3 years? If I have to reach what contingency plan and all I have to do? What is my potentiality? What is my strength? What certificate course? It's only, have you studied that book, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People? It's basically, sharpening the saw and cutting the tee, one habit. And read a lot kind of this kind of books also. You lot of engineers, you guys, don't, you are busy in clearing engineering or not busy in working and you don't read it any other books. Read how many books you read. There are applications which give summary of good books summarized. Be smart also. I don't say work hard only. When I'm reading a book, I said be smart. You will not be able to read at this age and experience. I will read 10 books, just go through it and smell it and throw it. I'll understand, get a kick up it and throw that book. But you may not be able to. But a lot of applications which is helping you. You know, they get the best of the books and summarize it. You need summary, conceptual. You don't need his English. You know his whole story, bullshit stories. Correct? So do that. Two, get that kind of, you know, book apps. Maybe Thriving in Chaos, Seven Habits of Highly People. You know, Managing the Change. Some of the best books are coming. 1% Club. I'm reading. I started reading the pandemic time through my Kindle only. Just like that. So read a lot. One, do your certificate course. Have your mapping done. Your Kundali. Hindi mein bolte na Kundali. 5 years mein kahan ja sakte hain? Kahan kahan my possibilities hai? Where all I can do? To reach that, to beat strategically other 100 applicants, what I have to prepare. Do it, yeah, the game is over, yeah. And I can write a bet with all of you guys. I can even write it today, 5 years each one of you agreement. How you will not reach that level. And all those things are not possible if you are not potential. If your IQ is not good, all of your potential, all of your IQ is good, all of your communication is good. Am I right? Without seeing you guys closely, am I concluding rightly or wrongly? Tell me. You are potentially good. Your communication is good. Your IQ is reasonable enough. Then what is it? Only little complacency, already retired without working from multiple perspectives. Okay, guys. Chalo, all
sir,
the best.
Sir, one thing. So out of this, the intent of having this course for me, this is equivalent to masters. But yeah. Sir, if this course would further help us to pursue in terms of PhD, or this is not be treated as a masters?
See, this course can give you three benefits. One is that it's an excellent course. We are getting to know generally about various concepts, right? Whether it is HR, finance, everything which you should know. According to me today, there is nothing like specialization in management. If I even get into the curriculum development of MBA, I will remove the concept of specialization. Everything everyone should read. HRM, marketing, finance, everything everyone should read. They should specialize in sectors, IT sector, pharma sector, tourism sector.
No. So my question was something else.
Yeah.
Since this is to get into a PhD, this thing, master's is the...
You are eligible. You are eligible. You are saying that I'm eligible to register for PhD. Yes, you are eligible.
Okay. So
because it's a given university.
So because not many university do acknowledge executive MBA as a master's. No,
this is given by the university, Dayanand Sagar University.
Okay.
So your degree is given by the university.
So that means this is equivalent to master's, and subsequently you are going through
all the credit courses.
Okay.
Not like a diploma course. Say, for example, MBA students are supposed to clear, say, 104 credit courses. Argument sake.
Mm-hmm.
Total. That is a norm given by AICT or somebody else. Okay. So 100 credit courses of 10 subject or 15 subject or 8 core courses or 10 elective courses. You are going through all the courses. Only thing is, you don't come in the daytime. You come in the evening time. Now online. Now the situation changed it. If there was no online, it could have been some evening, Saturday, Sunday classes also, right? So you are going through the credits prescribed for MBA. Say 104 course, I think now they're even reducing the AICT. I used to teach students even 150, 200 courses. But now the concept is changing. They are saying that don't give them too many credits. Give them less credit, but ask them to study in depth. I agree with them. So one, it is given by university. Two, you are reading all the courses like a full-time MBA guy. It's not like a diploma. You are not doing a diploma of he is studying 10 courses, you are studying 5 courses. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, professor. Yes.
So, and further, you based on this basic concept, you trying to think which line you want to get more. Don't stop here. You embellish this with the right certificate course.
Okay, no, my long-term perspective is I'll connect with you, Professor, offline.
Yeah, so I will connect with you one-to-one to understand what are the future prospects
for me. Better. You guys take time from me, write to me, then I'll definitely help you one-to-one. I'll be too happy to help you.
Yeah, so let's finish this course probably, then I will connect with you because
this is the first success. I need help. I need to go through. There is one more book I read it, I think. I am not getting the title of the book. Seven Heights of Highly Effective People. There's one more book I read. In that back, that book said that first admit I need help. I need guidance. Start that route. You are through. You're getting my point. This all looks simple, but it's very practically valuable. I'm not saying that take me only as your guide. Anybody for that matter. Correct? This is the first success. I need help. I need to go through somebody how to go about it in my career. You realize that, you started that, your first success started. Okay, guys. Chalo, yes, anyhow, sir. You are most welcome to contact me.
Thanks a lot.
Please write to me, give me time, then I'll definitely revert back. I'm not the guy who will want to revert. I'll revert it. Okay. Chalo, then all the best.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you, Professor.
God bless all of you. Best wishes to all of you guys.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, sir.